Joining me now is Mr. Jim Ritterhoff. He is Executive Director and Co-Founder of Force Blue. We also have retired veterans, Mr. Will Hinkson, who is a Team One member, as well as Director of Advancement and Strategy for Force Blue. And last but not least, we have Mr. Jay Casello, who is a Team Two member. Thank you guys all for joining me today. I think we're going to start off with Mr. Jim Ritterhoff to give us a little bit of background on Force Blue. What is it? What does it do? And what is Force Blue's mission?
Thank you, Miranda. It's great to talk to you today. And please call me Jim. But Force Blue is the only nonprofit organization in the world that retrains and redeploys former special operations veterans like Will and Jay, who are with us today, alongside scientists to work on marine conservation missions, right? Our goal is really twofold. It's to provide an incredible workforce. We're talking about the most highly skilled underwater operators in the world, providing a workforce to the marine scientists and environmental community. But at the same time, helping our veterans who, may be lacking that mission, that sense of mission and of team that were such big parts of who they were in the military, and kind of restoring that. We say it's a mission to preserve and restore, and we mean that both from the environmental side and with our veterans. So the story of Force Blue is really, we're still in our infancy. We're only about 4 years old. It started because largely a dear friend of mine and of Will's and of Jay's, a guy named Rudy Reyes, who's a fellow co-founder, a former recon Marine, served a number of combat tours, both in Iraq and Afghanistan, who I had gotten to know through the entertainment world. My background is not as a veteran, but I worked in advertising marketing for a long time and entertainment. I met Rudy, we became very close friends, and I saw his struggles up close. I saw the challenges he was facing transitioning out of, such a high tempo lifestyle as he had in the military. And coincidentally, as luck would have it, I was going on a dive trip. I've been a diver my whole life, and I've been involved in marine conservation for a large part of that. And I just invited Rudy kind of on the spur of the moment to come with me. And we went down to the Cayman Islands to a friend of mine's dive resort, guy who was a general manager, a gentleman named Keith Somm. And the three of us spent a week together and diving. And at the end of that, Rudy said, look, this has done more for me than any therapy, any rehab, anything like that, because his troubles had been considerable, and he said, this is just phenomenal. I have to get more of my guys to experience that. And when we told Rudy that the beauty of the reefs and the marine life that he was seeing were all threatened, that this is rapidly disappearing, he said, we need to do something about it. And that's where this idea of taking these highly skilled operators like Will and Jay and putting them together with scientists. As I always say, the secret sauce of this thing is that, people who are not gonna listen to another climate change scientist talk about what's happening to our oceans because we're such a divided country. Well, they'll listen to recon Marines and Air Force Para Rescue Men and Navy SEALs because these guys are their heroes. So that was it. That was, we did our first training deployment that Will was a part of in 2017 and immediately became operational and have been working over the last 3 years on everything from, coral reef restoration in the wake of hurricanes to coral disease intervention to sea turtle rescue. We've we're getting ready to do a big marine debris cleanup in January. So it's been an amazing ride. We've had some fabulous partners come on board. We've been involved for the last 2 years with the NFL and the Super Bowls, both in Miami and Tampa, doing a restoration project called 100 Yards of Hope that is a full ecosystem restoration effort in Miami. And the sky's the limit. We think we've proven the formula. you know, the scientists and SEALs, you know, we shorthand it as scientists and SEALs, but really all our special operations veterans, because we do have members from across all branches of the military. We even have a British Royal Marine and a British Special Boat Service veteran as part of our team. But the way they've come together with the scientific community, which at first, you know, seems like strange bedfellows, has been amazing. And I think everybody's benefited from it, and hopefully, you know, hopefully we're doing some good.
Thank you, Mr. Ritterhoff. So I think one of the most important topics that you just touched on there was the role of Force Blue in the transitioning process as far as these veterans going from their active years of service into a world outside of that. So on that, I kind of want to direct the focus towards Mr. Will Hinkson and then Jay Casello to be able to talk about the significance of this organization for them in that transition process and what it has meant to them in the long run.
Yeah, great question. And echo Jim's sentiments. Thank you for having us on here. Great to be speaking with you today. I think, at least for me, and I'll just kind of speak to my experience here, I had, gotten out, I had transitioned, I had started up my first business at the time, it was going, I put all my focus into that, was running that, but the thing that I think most of us crave, and I think, granted, this is probably one of the biggest misconceptions about especially special operations veterans that have combat experience. I think a lot of times when people look at that, they kind of look at it one of two ways, where it's like, these kind of like broken souls that are like maybe never going to be able to integrate into society the right way, or they kind of put us up on this pedestal as like kind of larger than life superheroes. The truth is we're all just human beings, right? But the thing that most of us crave more than anything else is that sense of camaraderie, that sense of teamwork, that sense of a mission that's bigger and larger than yourself and being a part of that. I know for me and for most of the guys that, you know, I'm super close with, that's the thing that we miss the most. That's the hardest part of transition. So it came at a really kind of critical time for me in my transition because I didn't have really that exposure to it anymore. Again, I'd put all my focus into business and things were going well, but there was this huge missing section in my life that really was that sense of team. And when I got to go over to the Caymans, it was, you know, within like, it was crazy how fast it happened. It was like within an hour of us getting together, it felt the same. It felt like being there with the guys, with the team, in the team room, learning stuff, putting that to good use. And, you know, Jim can speak to it as well. It was kind of crazy how fast this team came together. And then we came together as team two and kind of came in. So for me, it was a huge, huge piece that was missing in my transition to be able to come together, do something that was hard, do something that was a bigger mission, but do something that was restoring the world and did have this positive effect versus combat, which is, you know, largely destructive. I can't understate or overstate the importance of that for me and the impact that had.
Thank you so much, Will. So Mr. Jay Casello, can you kind of explain your transition process and why this organization is so important to you?
Sure, absolutely. Thanks for taking the time to talk with us. Wow, I really appreciate it. And man, everything Will said, honestly, I was just sitting here nodding. You know, so much of what he said resonates, and about having a team again. And really, you know, a team is doing an important mission. And I was fortunate because I was wrapping up 23 years of service in the Air Force, and you know, I was had my retirement plan, and Roger Sparks, who's teammate of Rudy's and Will's, Marine Force Recon, was a teammate of mine in pararescue, and I was so lucky to have him as a friend, and he got me, you know, he brought me into the system. So it really helped me, with the adjustment, even though it was 2 weeks in August, with team guys. But like Will said, it just came, like everything came back to feeling of working towards something bigger than you, something worth doing, something positive. You know, all those things came right back, like Will said. And, you know, then we started working with the scientists and having them train us to do like very detailed, groundbreaking work on the reef, saving coral, and which, you know, we still continue to do. And I mean, you know, you that sense of mission, purpose, you know, that's there for sure too. You know, that's what it gives.
So what kind of feedback are you guys getting from some of these people that are perhaps seeing these issues within our climate for the first time?
100%. I mean, it's actually been humbling how tremendous the response has been. I don't think any of us knew. I mean, we knew, you know, as Will said and Jay echoed, when we came together, we knew we had something special, but I don't think we even understood the power of the team, of bringing together these two seemingly different worlds, you know, the scientific world and the special operations world, what it could mean. I mean, I think testament to that is the fact that, you know, in very short order, we've been featured on, you know, the Today Show, CBS Evening News, through a lot of media platforms. We do take care to document everything that we do. So we always have our own film crew there, because we realize that what good is doing it if we can't share this story with the world, right? But I think that has been, you know, the most fulfilling part of it, really, apart from just the tremendous individuals that we have the pleasure to work with, both on the veteran side and the scientific community. You know, I think the scientific community is an amazing, amazing group of people. Across the board, the marine science, the scientists we've dealt with anyway, and they toil in a lot of anonymity, you know, because they're just out there every day doing what needs to be done. And the fact that we have a platform because of our uniqueness, because it is bringing a whole different audience, you know, people who are very interested in our veterans and obviously the debt that's owed to them, but suddenly they're now learning about things about the ocean. And I mean, none of us are scientists, you know, we're just, you know, people who see a need and want to answer, you know, see a fight that needs to be fought, right? But you think of things that are very simple for people to understand anywhere. You don't have to live by the ocean to understand the value of it when you consider that, you know, one out of every three breaths we take come from the ocean, right? And then these little nuggets like, all the rainforests in the world, if you add them up, generate less oxygen and sequester less CO2 than the coral reefs in our oceans. Yet nobody sees the coral reefs, so they don't know, you know, they don't have the same PR that the rainforests have, right? But they're in worse shape, you know. I think 90% of Florida's coral reef, which is where we've largely worked, is gone. You know, and that's a tragedy. It's a national treasure that, you know, we should be thinking of in terms of the way we think of Yellowstone National Park, Yosemite, or, you know, the wilds of Alaska. That this isn't a coral reef that is America's coral reef. It's the only one in the continental United States, and it's disappearing. And if we have an opportunity to raise awareness for that and to engage the public and the private sector and, you know, wanting to support it, even if they're not environmentalists, even if they just want to help guys like Will and Jay and all our guys, you know, continue serving, then that's a plus, right? So, you know, there's something we always say, look, and it's a particularly important now, you know, right now. In this partisan world that we live in, like we like to say, we don't care if you get on board from the left side or the right side, we're all in the same boat. And I think that's really the point of Force Boat.
So you guys are doing a pretty phenomenal job across the board. But I've got to ask, what do you guys see in the future for Force Blue? Multiple locations across the U.S., the world? Where do we see Force Blue down the line?
I mean, I'll kick that to Will. I mean, I'll start by saying I think really the sky's the limit. You know, there's no shortage. I've been blown away, frankly, over the last 4 years at the outreach we've received from veterans around the world, you know, from places like Brazil, Egypt, Israel, Australia, who all fit our very high criterion of being special operations, military trained divers who want to get involved. But Will, I'll kick it to you because, you know, you immerse yourself in what the future can be. So.
Yeah. I mean, I think when we look at this, and it's a great question, right? Like, what does the future look like for us? And I think it's twofold, right? It's what does it look like within conservation? And then also, what does it look like internally as we start to grow and expand, right? And so to kind of understand and answer that question, right? The short answer is we get opportunities that kind of blow my mind all the time from the scientific community reaching out. And it's tremendously fun to be a part of kind of the internal team and to see what's coming through and to go, oh my gosh, like I'm a newbie in conservation, but these folks are legends inside of this world. And it's a bit mind-blowing to see who we're working with. But to kind of answer your question, Miranda, I want to kind of talk about, you know, what's in the DNA and the essence of the special operations community, which is this. What are we uniquely designed to do that we can go in and do better than anyone else? And I think when we look at Force Blue, we look at a handful of components. One, because of the nature of Jim's background in marketing and advertising and some amazing teammates like Damien and some of the others, we're able to document some of this stuff and bring the story of what it looks like for conservation and to repair reefs for some of these plights that are absolutely afflicting these, as Jim said, national treasures that once they're gone, they are gone. So I think that's a component of specifically what we do and what the future holds is to tell the story of that in a compelling way with kind of a, you know, compelling cast of characters, if you will, doing very hard work and documenting the whole thing. The other piece of this, if you look at stuff like Puerto Rico, where we went down and then these giant coral heads had broken off, they'd fallen down. I mean, literally these folks were in tears, right? Because they had been diving on this for hundreds of years. This is an ecosystem that fishermen were using that, you know, it brought tourism to the local economy and they thought was gone, right? They'd named it Archie and they thought this thing was done. Because of the unique skill sets that we had inside of the diving world, our team was able to actually go down there, float that back up, and that's still here to this day. That would have been completely gone. And that was one of the major things that created that ecosystem. So when you look at this stuff, the answer really is what is the thing that's unique about us is we are able to go down and do really hard work with a very specific group of human beings that are highly trained, highly mission focused, work together very well, and are able to respond rapidly. So between that and between the ability to document and really bring the story of this stuff to a much larger group and a much larger segment that normally wouldn't have the exposure to it, you know, it's like anything, right? We make the analogy all the time. We want this to be as prolific as recycling, right? Recycling was not a thing, you know, 70 years ago. Right. When we look at this now, it's like we need to document this. We need to be able to enroll people inside of this journey, inside of this mission. And I think when we look at the future, it's going to be those specific missions that fit inside of that skill set where we're able to really turn the tide and actually make a change here.
I just want to add one last part to that, because I think what Will just touched on is really important, Miranda, is I think we want Force Blue to be seen as a call to service, right? Continued service for our veterans who need that larger than life, you know, that larger than themselves mission to kind of restore who they were and to prove that honestly their military training is not shouldn't be put on a shelf. It's silly, right? To spend millions of dollars training these men and women to be the best possible underwater operators and then say, you're 35, you've left the military, you know, here's a cubicle. It makes no sense. But service from the civilian side and the scientific side as well, like we need to re-engage people in the idea of getting involved, you know, and doing what they can, because there's a fight out there. This is nothing short of a conflict and a fight to save something that can't save itself. And nobody's coming to get us. This isn't going to be a problem that governments are going to solve on their own, right? It's up to us. And if guys like Will and Jay and all our teammates can be that inspiration and can make people want to serve again, then, you know, I think we've created a model for something much bigger than just, you know, just healing our oceans.
So this year has been tough on a lot of folks, but for those who still may be able to contribute to Force Blue in whatever form or fashion, how may they do so?
Well, I encourage everyone to visit our website, www.forceblueteam.org. Poke around, watch our videos, learn about us. If you can donate, we are a 501c3, so every donation we receive is tax deductible. And 100% of the funds that we raise go toward putting guys like Will and Jay back into service, back on the water, back in the water, and, you know, right now restoring reefs, but there's a whole lot more on the horizon. So forceblueteam.org, and tell our story. Help us tell our story. Share it with your friends. You know, talk us up.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Mr. Jim Ritterhoff, for your time. And thank you so much, Mr. Will Hinkson and Mr. Jay Casello, for your time and your service.
Stay tuned, because in early January, we're going to be hosting a 4-hour online event for Hope, which is really a celebration of Florida's coral reef and the fight to save, as we said, this national treasure. So everybody follow us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram. It's just @ForceBlueTeam, and look for 4Hope coming this January.